Well, good morning. Thank you for your patience. I was being hospitable and gracious to our guests. My name's Josh. I'm one of the pastors here. I'm glad that you've joined us on this cold and I guess still snowy Sunday morning. we definitely want to provide a warm, open, accessible environment for you to not only engage with one another, but primarily we want to engage with the living God who made us, who is intimately involved in every aspect of every one of our lives, whether we realize it or not, whether we believe it or not. We are, for those of you who are visiting, a Christian church. We believe that Jesus Christ is God, and so we will make much of Him. We will sing to Him, we'll pray in His name. We will, in our interactions, regularly be speaking of His involvement in our life and what He's doing and how we're coming to Him for help with our needs and whatever we're going through. We'll point to Him in the Scriptures as we learn what God has said to us about Him, and so He really is why we've gathered. If you don't know Him, you'll have an opportunity to know what it looks like to put your hope and faith in Him and begin to follow Him with us. But at the same time, there'll be no arm twisting or pressure or singling you out. We want this to be a place in which you've got time and space to learn, to ask questions, to think through, so that faith in Him will come from a place of knowledge and right response to Him. Only one quick little plug here before I read a scripture and then we go into our singing time is if you're new to the church, first off, if you're a visitor, we'd love to connect with you. We've got connect cards and QR codes in the bulletin and a connect desk, all avenues with which you can give us some information. We can follow up with you just to serve you in whatever is helpful. We'll follow up this week. But if you're a part of this church, maybe for a while, and have just come on Sunday mornings and attended, again, we want this pace to be one that's comfortable and ready to be involved in, but we take serious church membership, that to be a part of, to be in relationship with God is to be in relationship with people, and you just can't read the New Testament with realizing that there is an expectation among Christians that they would belong to a local, embodied group of fellow believers for mutual encouragement, accountability, and growth, and service, prayer, etc. And so Redemption Church takes that seriously. Again, we expect you to know what that means. We expect you to know what this church believes, what you believe, what expectations are of members, what you should expect of the church, what the church would expect for you, of you. And so we have a class. It starts this coming Sunday at 9 o'clock, and it will be 6 consecutive Sundays, 9 to 10 here. Child care is provided. You can sign up through our weekly email as well as at the Connect desk. And you're not required to be a member going through that course, but it is a prerequisite for membership. It's a great class. I teach, not because I teach it, but it's a great class because we go really deeply into what the church believes, what Christianity is, and not a class goes by in which we don't have someone come up and really appreciate the going to the scriptures to decide, not tradition or culture or just personality or preferences. So anyway, if you've not membered up, strongly consider that. And even if you think I don't want to be a member, take the class anyway, so that you know why you don't, and we can maybe find you another church that will be a better connection. In line of that, go ahead and stand. Romans 12 verses 4 through 8. Is a scripture along those lines, and it ties into what we're doing a little bit here in worship as well. For as it's a metaphor of how a church is a body, so as a physical body is connected, so is a spiritual body. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another, having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Let us use them. If prophecy in proportion to our faith, if service in our serving, the one who teaches in his teaching, the one who exhorts in his exhortation, the one who contributes in his generosity, the one who leads with zeal, the one who does acts of mercy with cheerfulness. And we've got every one of those gifts represented. And all of those gifts are even represented in different styles and personalities. But we find our unity in Christ. And we'll express that unity in singing now. Welcome to Redemption Church.
I didn't see a whole lot of lips moving out there.
Deep in our hearts, let us record the deepest sorrows of our Lord.
Thank you.
again. Me, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. Those first two songs were fairly dark, would you agree? A lot of death, a lot of hopelessness, a lot of sorrow and suffering. We're talking about, you know, pictures of Christ on the cross, and, you know, our sins put Him there, and running our hell-bound race. Boy, I'm great at that. I'm running in my own power and strength and competencies. Like, I'm winning the hell-bound race, church. But God, being rich in mercy, while we were running our hellbound race, He said, no, that's not how this is going to go. I'm going to intercede. I'm going to save my people. And it is because of His work in salvation. It is because of His grace, of His steadfastness. Give me, He will hold me fast. It is His work in our lives. Through our faith, His work that holds us fast, that keeps us saved, that turns the destination of the race from hell to His presence. He holds us fast, and He will hold us fast.
When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, He will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold, He must hold me. Are His delight, Christ will hold me fast. Precious in His holy sight, He will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost, His promises shall last. Bought by Him at such a cost, He will hold. Is turned to sight when He comes at last. repeat. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. For my Savior.
Father God, it is by your plan and your great mercy that you sent your Son to die for our sins, raised him up by the power of the Holy Spirit, seated him at your side in heaven, and we look forward to his return. And it is that truth of the gospel that we cling to. But we know that it is you that holds us in our hand, in your hand. And so we rest. Amen. Please be seated.
Morning. Our theme for prayer time this morning is international missions. But before we just jump into prayer, I thought it might be helpful to provide a little context and some information that not only will help us this morning in prayer, but also as you go through the week in your individual prayer time, your prayer time with your gospel communities. So I want to start by showing a slide. There it is, that shows the logos of all of the international mission organizations that Redemption Church either partners with or that members of our church have served in short-term missions opportunities over the last year. And there's two of them that we're going to pick to talk about or to pray about today. The first one is the kind of the circle red cross logo up on the top right. That's Sojourn Church. And that's a Acts 29 church in Kampala, Uganda. It's pastored by a man that we call B-Dubs. He's Ugandan, but he's married to an American missionary named Meredith. And they just had a brand new baby, Parker. And Redemption's partnered with Sojourn Church for many years. We've sent short-term teams over there in the past. And this week, I reached out to B-Dubs, telling him that we were going to be praying for him this morning, and asked him, what can we pray as a church for him and for Sojourn Church? And he shared three things with me. The first is family-related. As I mentioned, they just had this new baby, Parker, and they would love to bring him back to the United States to introduce him to family and friends. And so that's apparently a challenging process with paperwork, getting passports and visas and all the arrangements made, and they've run into several roadblocks. And so he's asking us to pray that those roadblocks would be broken down and they'd be able to finally show their new son to their loved ones. The second thing he asked us to pray for is follow-up from some outreach events that they've had. So they had an outreach event in December related to Christmas. They also had something that they called youth camp over the school break in January, which is basically like a vacation Bible school for teenagers. They had 60 campers that came to that, and between the youth camp and the Christmas outreach, they had several people come to Christ. And so he's asked that we pray for those new believers in their midst. And then the third thing is they've got a man in their congregation named Jonathan, who is apparently an up-and-coming leader. And he's asked that we pray for Jonathan, that he would have wisdom and a heart to serve. So we're going to pray for those things for Sojourn. The other logo that we want to pray for today is on the bottom right there, Crew. And I know many people here are familiar with Crew. They've got a really thriving ministry there on the campus of Marshall. But in addition to a campus ministry, they also have an international component. And in fact, in March, there's going to be some teams heading here from Huntington down to Cuba on one of those short-term mission trips. And one of the leaders of that trip is our own Michaela Marshall. And so on that trip, they're going to be, it's kind of a humanitarian trip that they're going to be going down installing filters into the water systems down there for people who don't have access to clean drinking water. And they're going to use that as an opportunity then to share the gospel with the impoverished people that they they interact with. And so we want to pray for Michaela and for that team, particularly for the preparations between now and when they leave. I understand that there's some members of the team that are very inexperienced travelers, so that's going to add a layer of complexity to the trip, I'm sure. Of course, we want to pray for the people that will be receiving the practical help with clean water, that their hearts would also be open to receive the gospel. And then we also want to pray for the local Cuban churches, that they would be prepared and equipped to disciple the new believers that come about because of this ministry. So we're going to pray about those things this morning. So if you just bow your heads with me, and we'll lift those things up to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, as integral as international missions are to your plan for bringing the gospel message to the ends of the earth, we acknowledge that this is not how it was supposed to be. Missions wasn't an element of your original design for creation. To quote one of our contemporary theologians, missions exist because worship does not. And so, Lord, we confess and ask forgiveness for our sin that makes missions necessary. Starting with Adam and through the ages up until the current time, where our rebellion has provided an ample mission field. But by your grace and your mercy, you have redeemed missions. You have turned it from a tragic consequence of sin to a beautiful roadmap of salvation for the spiritually dead. You've flipped the script on Satan, countering a single act of disobedience in the garden with countless celebrations by the heavenly hosts every time a lost sheep is brought into your flock through the labor of missionaries. And you've invited us to participate in this master plan by calling us to make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all the commands that you've given to us. And so, in obedience to that call, we lift up to you our brothers and sisters who are on the front lines of this great commission. First, we praise you for the fruit that you're producing through Sojourn Church. How encouraging it is to hear reports of people putting their faith in Christ Jesus during the Christmas outreach event and the youth camp. We pray that these new believers would be secure in their faith. They would not be like the seed that's scattered on rocky soil, who receive it with joy, only to fall away because there's no root. May Sojourn Church be the place of good soil, where this new faith is nurtured and grows. We pray for B-Dubs and Meredith as they urgently desire to travel back to the United States to celebrate the birth of their son Parker with family and friends. Please streamline the bureaucracy that's holding up their paperwork so they can come soon and even perhaps come here to Redemption Church to be encouraged and to encourage us. We also pray for this brother Jonathan in their church, who has such promise and potential for gospel leadership. Would you give him wisdom and build up a heart to serve in the capacity that you've called him, giving him peace in the decisions that are made along the way? We also want to lift up our sister Michaela in prayer today as she prepares with her team to serve the lost and suffering in Cuba. It's hard for us to imagine living without access to clean drinking water and what a burden that must be. So we ask that you would give this team from Crew success as they provide for the basic needs of these people. But just like the woman at the well, we know that their real need is for spiritual living water. And so may this need be met also. We pray that the door of their hearts would be open to hear and receive the gospel of Jesus Christ. Trusting that you will answer this prayer in a big way, we also ask that you would equip the Cuban churches to receive the influx of new believers and integrate them into the fellowship with the other believers to build and strengthen the faith of all your children. We pray for all these things, asking that Jesus Christ become greater and greater as we become less and less. Amen. And before I step down here, just wanted to say, if you want more of this, meaning more updates on missions, more time to pray for missionaries, more time to celebrate what God is doing through missions, I want to invite you to the midweek service that will be happening on January 31st. There we go. I'm longing for summer, you can tell. Come on January 31st, the midweek service, and we're going to do more of this. So look forward to seeing you there.
Well, there's something about great works of art or great pieces of music or great literature that demands not only our attention, but our respect. While at the same time, those things on the surface are many times hard to get your head around, hard to see what's going on. Meaning we're told that they're great. We know people that think they're great and are deeply moved by them, but at least on our first impression or two, we're shaking our heads thinking, what is the big deal about this? For example, the Mona Lisa. You all have heard of that. You have that image in your mind. I don't need to put it up. Is that great? Why? Looks like any other picture to me. But for people who know and have realized the context and where it fell and the history of artistic development and perhaps some of the environment involved, maybe other things that I'm clueless about, can give you lots of reasons and discover why it's great. Or what about jazz? Some of you are jazz heads. Others of you are not jazz heads, and you don't get what the big deal is. But there are things like that, whether it's Shakespeare or Homer, that you had to read in school, and if you dig below the surface, if you put the work in, if you take time to consider, if you open up your mind, maybe broaden your perspective, grow in your curiosity. Try to get to the root of greatness. You'll discover that not only do you know why, but you can find yourself starting to love it yourself. I experienced that, again, in the whole area of art this past fall. My daughter, as many of you know, is going to school in Ohio, and she was taking a humanities class, and I was helping her with some of one of her papers, and in this particular paper, they were tracking some of the classical art theory and different things, and which I know nothing about, and so I had to do some research and got into the weeds of one of the things she was working with, which was the winged victory of Samothrace. You know what that is? I didn't, and It sits today in the Louvre in Paris, and it is a headless goddess of Nike, from which the sports shoes and apparel gets their name, actually. And it's carved into marble on what looks like the brow of a ship, and looks like she's going to fly away. And it is so lifelike and human, it literally looks like she's about to take flight. And even though it's carved into marble, she's got like a translucent sort of garment on that it looks like you can see through it. Why is that great? I don't know, but through the digging in and getting involved, I walked away thinking, I've got to go see this. I thought about putting it up here, but I didn't feel good about putting a goddess statue up in the middle of a church on Sunday to sear our conscience. Another one, and this is what ties into my sermon today, was a piece of music that came to mind when I was thinking about this title of Jesus that we're going to work on in our series of the names and titles of Jesus, that Jesus is the Messiah. And I have to confess that my first thought that came into my mind when I said the word Messiah wasn't Jesus, but it was the musical masterpiece by George Frederick Handel. And I'd just come off of Christmas, which was the second year that I had listened to it completely performed over the Christmas season, and is a beautiful piece of music. You probably know the Hallelujah Chorus, and that's all you can appreciate, but it's got so much more. Dean, I actually had you, I can play a little of it, and some of you will hate it, and some of you will like it, but it'll prove my point a little bit. You got that ready? All right, some of you know that from R.C. Sproul's opening for Renewing Your Mind podcast, but that's actually from The Messiah. And engaging in about 3-4 hours of that over December, it not only deepened my appreciation of Jesus Christ over the Christmas season, but it gave me a finality to the end of my year as I reflected on all that had happened and all that I was anticipating and the glorious work of God in all of it. But some of you, that's just flying completely over your head, and you're unwilling to push past that to get to all the enjoyment that could be had, and that among a thousand other things that God has given us, many of it, most of it, through human achievement. Well, what the winged victory of Samothrace is to sculptures and Handel's Messiah is to Christmas music, Jesus' title of Messiah is to his names. Meaning, you've heard of it. You sing the word when we put it up in a number of songs. You have some concept of that it's a big deal within Christianity that Jesus is Messiah. But most Christians don't have a clue what it is that we're singing when we say Jesus is Messiah. Certainly not all the depth and nuance and beauty that is there. And I want there to be more than that for us. I want you to push through the boundaries of your intellectual capacity to understand initially. I want you to do the hard work of investigating what it means biblically, why it means what it means, why it was important that Jesus was the Messiah, and the implications that it has for us today. I want you to not relegate the title to just, we'll let nerds like Josh, who's a preacher and gets into the weeds of such things and likes the winged victory of Samothrace and Handel, he can fool with it. No. We all, you don't have to like the music I like or the sculptures that I'm interested in, but we need to know biblically Messiah. Not just so you have an answer, but so that you can go into the depths of the God and Savior who is not only yours, but will be yours forever through faith. Now, to take a little bit of the pressure off so you don't feel like I'm calling you Neanderthals because you're not into some of this stuff, is a perfectly reasonable explanation that you wouldn't know what it means that Jesus is Messiah. We don't traffic in that phrase very often. We occasionally will come across that title for athletes or political figures of some sort, but there's no real reason for us to know other than in churchy type of environments. To make matters even more reasonable that we wouldn't know, it's only mentioned, the word Messiah is only mentioned 4 times in your Bible. Did you know that? 2 times in the Old Testament and 2 times in the New Testament. To make it even more sort of isolated, those 4 occasions happen in 2 books, twice in Daniel and twice in the Gospel according to John. To make it even more obscure, when it shows up in Daniel, in our ESV translation, which we use to preach and read from in our Sunday morning gatherings, it's not even translated Messiah. Although the Hebrew word is Messiah, they translate it into a different English phrase. So you will actually be reading in Daniel the title Messiah and not realize you are because of that translation decision. Now, the good news is that because it's only four times, we can handle them all today fairly quickly. So go first to Daniel in your Old Testament, chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9 is a context in which God has given this prophet a specific prediction about the future. But we're not going to get into that. I basically just want you to see the word and the concept and see if you can find Messiah in it. Won't be hard. Know therefore and understand that from the going out of the word to restore and build Jerusalem, so there's a time marker, to the coming of an anointed one, a prince, there shall be 7 weeks. Then for 62 weeks it shall be built again with squares and moat, but in a troubled time. And after the 62 weeks, an anointed one shall be cut off and shall have nothing. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. So you see where Harry Potter ripped off the Bible there. Marvel did it last week. Harry Potter does it this week. And so the title for Messiah there is the Anointed One. But in Hebrew, the word is not anointed one. It is literally Mashiach, from which we get the word Messiah in Hebrew. But I'll talk more about that in a second. Turn next to the New Testament and find John chapter 9. John 1. And we'll look at verse 41. He, that would be Andrew, a disciple who had encountered Jesus, first found his own brother Simon, whose other name was Peter, and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which means Christ. Go to John 4. You see the last time in the Bible it shows up. This is Jesus interacting with a woman from Samaria by a well. And we will find verse 21. And you'll read it again. Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father," because there was some debate over where true worship happened. "You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here where the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth." We're in that moment. "For the Father is seeking such people to worship Him. God is spirit, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, He who is called Christ, and when He comes, He'll tell us all these things." And Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am He." Did you notice something that the New Testament did there that the Old Testament didn't? Each time that the word Messiah was brought up, first with Andrew, he said, "We have found the Messiah," and then in parentheses, you read, "which is called Christ." Same thing happened here in chapter 4. "I know that Messiah is coming, He who is called Christ." So come with me. Remember, you're going to have to go below the surface. It can't be enough for me to just give you a title. We're going to trace this and track this, and it means you need to get into it. You need to think. You need to broaden, you need to deepen, you need to expand, overcome your blindness, your boredom, your inadequacies. And part of it is to trace this whole idea of words and titles. And if you do this well, I hope that this understanding of Jesus as Messiah will stick permanently in your brain. So from now on, when you sing the songs, whenever you hear another sermon on it, or you read it in the scriptures, or it is referred to by a pastor or someone else, you will immediately not just understand sort of the concept, but the broad, detailed involvement biblically of all that it is. Okay, well, first off, we need to do a little Hebrew-Greek understanding. I've already mentioned that in Hebrew, the Greek word is, or excuse me, the word for Messiah is Mashiach. In Greek, you just read it, it is Messias, which they have just completely transliterated their Greek or their Hebrew word over into Greek and said Messias. But what Mashiach means in Hebrew is not what the word Messiah would mean in Greek. They have another word for that, and it's krio. It's a verb, krio. The noun version of that would be Christos, Christ, translated here. In krio, C-H-R-I-O, the way you would write it in English, krio means to anoint. It means to smear. It means to spread out a liquid out over something. That's exactly what Mashiach, you know you're saying it right when you spit. It's a guttural sound. Mashiach, sorry there in the first row. And that means to anoint, to smear, to spread out. So when you say Messiah in Hebrew, you are saying to anoint, to smear, to spread out. If you want to say that in Greek, you would say krio. I put that all together to say they're answering. So while the word Messiah is only spoken of twice in your New Testament, Christ is everywhere, and it means the same thing. That's not his last name. It is a title. Jesus, who is the Christ. Jesus, who is the Mashiach. Jesus, who is the Anointed One. All synonymous ways to give him that title. All right? So that's what the word is and what the word means. Now let's go to the next level. What is the importance of someone being anointed? What is the importance of someone having oil smeared on them or a liquid spread out over them? Well, we discover in the Old Testament, which this foundation or this title is foundationally laid, there are only three groups or three types of people who would be anointed. I'll give them to you on the front, and then I'll show them to you where they are. First would be prophets. Second would be priests. And third would be kings. Go to 1 Kings chapter 19. This is a good verse. There are plenty of verses where I could show you this, but I want to show you 1 Kings 19, because we can hit two of those positions in the same verse. God is speaking to Elijah, who is a miracle-working major prophet in the Old Testament. And in verse 15, God gives him a command. The Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when you arrive, you shall anoint," there's our word, Mashach. You shall Mashach Hazael to be king over Syria. And Jehu, the son of Nimshi, you shall Mashach anoint to be king over Israel. And Elisha, that was Elijah's partner and protege in ministry. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abel Meholah, you shall Mashach to be prophet in your place. So you see both the kings and the prophets were to be anointed. Go next to Exodus. This would be the second book of your Bible, the Old Testament. Find chapter 28, and there we'll see that priests likewise had to be anointed, or were. And find verse 40. For Aaron's sons, you shall make coats and sashes and caps. This is God giving the law to Moses and the Israelites. And you shall make them for glory and for beauty. And you shall put them on Aaron your brother and on his sons with him, and shall anoint them and ordain them and consecrate them, that they may serve me as priests. So priests were anointed for their position and their work. Prophets were anointed for their position and their work. Kings were anointed for their position and their work. That's why David, and probably in what is one of the most famous Psalms, Psalm 23, says, "You have anointed my head with oil. You have placed on me a position and a work, a calling that sets me apart for you." Now, deeper. Okay, so that's what Messiah is and means. That's who gets it. Now, what comes along with that anointing? oversimplification, and I've done a lot of the work, but three things. To begin with, it means that you are an authorized servant of God. That you are authorized for that position and that role by God's choice. That means that not anybody and everybody gets to decide that they're a prophet. That God picked them as a prophet, and He, with that anointing, set them apart for the office of communicating the Word of God without error as revelation to the community. And with that anointing that came from other prophets, sometimes from the priests, they would then be able to say, that one is an authorized figure that we should listen to. They've got a voice that carries credibility. Sometimes the prophets in the Old Testament aren't even referred to as prophets, but they are referred to as God's anointed, right? God's smeared, God's spread with liquid, God's Mashiach, in that type of sense. Same thing with priests. When priests were anointed, they were set apart as an authorized group of people that could offer sacrifices that would be acceptable on behalf of the sins of the nation. Some of those priests would have extra anointings that would allow them to go into parts of the temple the other priests couldn't go. And there were parts of the temple that only priests could go. They weren't allowed to eat certain things at times. They weren't allowed to touch certain things or be touched, or they would lose that anointing, because they would lose their authorization to continue into the work that God gave them. Same thing with kings. Second, divine power came with that anointing. Not necessarily miraculous. Sometimes the miraculous, but not always. Sometimes it was divine enablement. It would come upon them ability to do what God has called them to do. That God wouldn't just say, here's your position, here's what I'm calling you to do, now good luck, go do it in your own ability. He would empower them to do what God had called them to do. The great prayer of Augustine of Hippo that we many times will pray around here is, God, command what you will, but grant what you command. Give me the ability to do what you call me to be. That's very much in line with this whole concept of anointing. Sometimes it did involve the miraculous. Sometimes it involved telling the future. Sometimes it was ability to see the unseen. But divine enablement came to do what God called you to do. Third, there was an understanding that there is an ultimate anointing and anointed one to come. All of the prophets, all of the priests, and all of the kings realized that they had an interim anointing. That it was a limited anointing. It was an anointing that was for a specific time, an era, or purpose, or season, or activity. But they were looking forward to one who would ultimately be anointed, and he would be greater than all of them combined. Moses said, I'm a prophet, but there is coming a prophet that will be greater than I. David was told, you are the greatest king Israel has ever had. To this day, there's the Star of David on their flag. There's the city of David as their capital. But David was told that one of your descendants will inherit your kingdom, and it will be a kingdom that will never, ever end. He will be your Lord, ultimately. And then the whole book of Hebrews in the New Testament is a treatise of showing how the priesthood of Jesus Christ, the Messiah, that he has received, is far superior than the priesthood that we read about in the Mosaic covenant that I just read of in Exodus. But to put it succinctly, the anointed one to come, the ultimate anointing that would be arriving in this figurehead that they referred to as the Mashiach, the Messiah, would be one who fulfilled all the promises of God about all of the kingdom of God for all of the people of God. And that context in which it was given and expected was a Jewish context. It was Jewish promises about a Jewish land and a Jewish people and a Jewish kingdom with a Jewish Messiah. That's why it blew their minds in the New Testament when God said, that's true, but I've broken down all the ethnic barriers, all of the divide, that everyone gets in to this kingdom. That this Jewish Messiah would be a world Messiah, be a Palestinian Messiah. It would be an American Messiah. It would be a Russian Messiah. That he would be coming for the whole world. And he would be the ultimate prophet, the ultimate priest, ultimate king. He would not only speak to God, to us, be the perfect revelation of God to humanity. He would be the perfect manifestation of humanity back to God. He would be a king that would never fail, who would always do right, perfect justice. He would bring about infinite peace. He would be a priest that not only brought sinners into the presence of God through their sacrifice, but he would be the sacrifice himself as the lamb who would die on their behalf. All of that is entailed in Messiah. Those who count the verses in the Old Testament, I didn't, of all of the promises of this one who was to come, probably the capstone work on this is by Alfred Edersheim in his two volumes, they're probably different abridgments, but on the life and times of Jesus the Messiah, where he lists over 450 promises. And in an appendix to that work, I looked at it this past couple weeks, in the appendix of the work, very small print, he'll list the verse and the promise of Messiah and then a brief explanation of how Jesus fulfilled that. It was in appendix, volume 2, appendix 9, from pages 710 to 741. And he included the Apocrypha, which is the books between written between the Old Testament and the New Testament, which aren't inspired revelation, but were read and looked to by the Jewish people in that era, as well as rabbinical writings. And at the end of all of this list, he says, despite all labor and care, it can scarcely be hoped that this list is quite complete. Genesis to Malachi, thousands of years, multiple authors, multiple contexts, multiple environments, all saying, he's coming. He's coming. Keep waiting. Keep looking. Keep anticipating. And it's in that context that we read of the first appearance of the word Messiah in John 1. So go back to that. Now that you have this full background, see already you're appreciating it. You're like an art appreciator. You'll be able to walk into the Louvre and say, now did you notice this? This is all. Notice how the wings did that. This was an innovation. Or you listen to Messiah and you understand the. Now you can do that with Christ. When you talk of Jesus, when you speak of him, you can be somewhat of an expert. You'll be a hit at parties. John chapter 1. Let's go back to verse 19. I just read the verse in which Messiah, the Word, appeared, but let's get the full context. This is the testimony of John the Baptist. When the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, who are you? You're doing great. You've got a great crowd. You've got a prophetic message. You're baptizing people. Who are you? He confessed, but did not deny, but confessed, I am not the Christos. I am not the Mashiach, the one you've been waiting on. It's not me. They asked, well, what then? Are you Elijah? He said, I'm not. Are you the prophet? He answered, no. So they said to him, who are you? We need to give an answer to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself? He said, I'm just the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord. Now they had been sent by the Pharisees, and they asked him, then why are you baptizing if you are neither the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet? John answered, I baptize with water as a symbol, but among you stands one who you do not know, even he who comes after me, the strap of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie. These things took place in Bethany across the Jordan where John was baptized. And Jesus will later go on to say, John is one of the greatest prophets that we've ever had. Perhaps the greatest of the prophets. You ask John about that, John said, I'm not worthy to tie the Christ's shoe compared to the prophets, the type of prophet and priest and king that he will be. The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him, and he said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks before me because he was before me.'" He's attesting to Jesus' deity. John was born before Jesus. He wasn't there before Jesus. Or Jesus wasn't there before John, humanly speaking. John's ministry preceded Jesus' ministry. Jesus wasn't there before John's ministry. He followed it. But yet he is saying, he precedes me because this is God in the flesh. He's the Christ. He is the Mashiach. He is the one for whom we've been waiting. Look at verse 35. "The next day, John was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said again, 'Behold the Lamb of God.' The two disciples heard him and heard him say this, and they followed Jesus." So he lost his church. His people started leaving his church and going, not a church, but his following, and following Jesus. So he is the one to come. Look at verse 40, same chapter. "One of the two who heard John speak and followed Jesus was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his own brother Simon and said to him, 'We have found the Messiah,'" which means Christ. Verse 43, "The next day Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, 'Follow me.' Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, 'We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote,'" that all those 450 prophecies and promises, "we found him." He said, "It's Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." The Pharisee said, "Are you him?" John said, "I'm not him, it's him." The disciples of John said, who is it?" He said, "It's Jesus." And they went and told the next person, the next person, the next person. The point is they're waiting. They're anticipating. You find people only if you're looking. A.T. Robertson said, "These disciples had made the discovery of the ages. It was far beyond gold or diamond mines. Far greater than any classic piece of work that we unearth in archaeology. Greater than any masterpiece of literature. Greater than any music that could be made. They had found the one of whom had been promised to satisfy all the longings of their hearts, all the answers to their questions, all of the clarity to their confusion, all of their purpose and meaning in life. And they began to follow him. You say, well, did Peter always, what we see there was he was told. We'll go to Matthew chapter 16. Look, one of the great statements of Jesus being the Messiah and the Christ is there, made by Simon. He's called Peter as well. Verse 13, "When Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, 'Who do people say that the Son of Man is? What's the word on the street? What's the gossip? What's the rumor mill saying about all this stuff that I'm saying and doing?' They said, 'Well, some say that John the Baptist has come back to life. Others say Elijah. Others say that you're Jeremiah or one of the prophets.'" So Jesus gets more personal. He said to them, "Well, who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ. You're the Son of the living God." Notice, the Christ. Not a Christ. Not an anointed one. Not a prophet, priest, or king among many. You're the Christ. In fact, you're the Son of the living God. Go to John 10. Still going. John 10, verse 10. I think. No, let's start verse 22. There's been a claim. Dan Brown, the Da Vinci Code author, did this a number of years ago. It's not uncommon to every now and then hear it now, that Jesus never claimed to be God. He never claimed to be this deified figure. That was just followers of his day or followers after to sort of consolidate power or get their agenda across. I one time was at in the locker room of the YMCA over here, whatever street that is, and had some friendships in there. And as an older guy who knew I was a preacher and had some questions, and for whatever reason, when we're changing to get back into our clothes, it turned into stump the Bible man in there, and they were asking me questions and trying to stump me. And this guy would say, well, Jesus never really claimed to be God. That's just something his followers did. You can't find one statement in there where Jesus said he's God. And I said, all right, well, let's get out John chapter 10, and we started to look at verse 22. You guys started this, and so we'll go. In verse 22, at the time the feast of dedication took place at Jerusalem, it was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple in the colonnade of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, how long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, if you are the Messiah, tell us plainly. Jesus answered them, I told you, and you do not believe. And the works that I do in my Father's name bear witness to me. You don't have to just take my word for it that I am the Christ. The works I'm doing show that I'm the Christ. I'm doing things only God can do. Only the Christ can do. But you don't believe me because you're not a part of my flock. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life. Imagine making that statement. Only God could say something like that. And they'll never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one. He is claiming equality with God. And I let it hang there for those guys in that locker room because I knew what they were going to say, and I wanted their jaws to get cocked before I came in with an uppercut. As I said, see, he's just claimed equality with God. He claimed he's deity. The Father's God, and he's saying he's God too. They said, no. That just means unity. He's in unison. He's on mission. They share the same values. They got the same agenda. They're consistent in their teaching. I said, how do you know that? Well, it's obvious. I said, well, let's ask the people who were there what they thought he said. Whether they think they agree with me or they agree with you. Well, how do we know that? Well, verse 31 says, the Jews picked up stones again to stone him. They're going to kill him. Why? For saying that he is on the same page as God the Father? That he was just teaching the same stuff in unison on the same mission? Jesus answered, I've shown you many good works from the Father. For which of them are you going to stone me? Which one am I dying for? The Jews answered him, it is not for a good work that we are going to stone you, but for blasphemy, because you being a man, make yourself God. They knew that's what he was saying, because that was what he was saying. To claim to be Christ was to be a deity. Well, look what else. Go to last one. I think it's the last one. Yeah, last one. Luke chapter 24. Back one book before John. Luke 24. Jesus has been raised from the dead at this point. It's just a few days, really, since Jesus had been raised. And he's still making the claim of deity, still making the claim of being Messiah and Christ. Verse 13, that very day, two of them, these are two disciples of Jesus, meaning people who'd followed him, not the 12, but he had many disciples beyond the 12, were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. And while they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near. This is a resurrected Christ. And he went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, what is this conversation that you're holding with each other as you walk? They stood still, looking sad. And one of them, named Cleopas, answered, are you the only visitor in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened here in these days? And he said to them, what things? And they said to him, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped he was the one to redeem Israel. He would have been the Christ. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things had happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they didn't find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who had said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said. And him they did not see. He said to them, O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. You know all those 450 or more promises? You don't believe them, and you've forgotten that it was necessary, verse 26, that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory. Those were promises. And how would you like to be in this Bible study, beginning with Moses? And all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. John the Baptist said he was the Messiah. The Old Testament said he was the Messiah. The disciples of Jesus said he was the Messiah. Jesus himself said he was the Messiah. What about you? We didn't go through all 450, but I'll do that with you if you need to or want to. But for 2,000 years, there have been people lining up based on what I've done right there and more that have said, he's the Christ. He is the Son of the living God. All of my needs, and they are many, will be met by him alone. All the questions that I have, he has answers. All the perspective I need, he gives it. All of the hope for the future, I have confidence in his promises. The mess I've made of my life, he can fix. The relationships that are jacked up, he can restore. The sickness that I have, he can heal. And even if he doesn't, he'll raise me from the dead one day. He's the Messiah. I want you to do that if you've not. I'm always regularly expecting and considering that there will be people among us who have never done that. So to close, I want to give you three things that you're doing when you come to Christ like this. First, you are claiming Jesus to be the anointed one of the Bible. He's it. You're not looking for another. The Old Testament gave a very extensive resume and said this is what he will be. The New Testament clearly demonstrates he checks all the boxes. And it's a hard resume to check, but he does it. Second, we declare our search for all other messiahs are over. Stop putting your hope in other messiahs. Jesus promised there will be antichrists. There will be other messiahs that will come and go from his coming and his second coming. Stop looking. You found him. You found all of the answers in Christ, all of the purpose and resolution in him. And this is really applicable to Christians, because I find many Christians who will say, yes, Jesus is my Messiah, but then they will begin to line up their life and their passions and their priorities with other saviors. What Keller calls functional saviors or heart idols. To come to Jesus as Messiah is not, okay, he will be my Messiah one day in the coming kingdom, but now I need a social program that I need to get behind for my hope of making change in this world or in my life. Or, yeah, I'll have Jesus as my Messiah when his kingdom comes again, but now I need a political leader that I will look to, and he will bring order and justice out of the chaos. He will bring economic prosperity, which will make me happy. Or yes, Jesus is my Messiah when his kingdom comes, but I need to also contribute with my own religious performance. I'll help. No. Peter made another great statement. I said I lied to you. I said Luke was going to be the last one. John chapter 6, if you want to turn there, great. But since I told you you didn't have to, you can just read or listen as I read or see it on the screen. It's another great statement of Peter. Jesus was making some hard statements in verse 66. And he said, and after this, many of the disciples turned back. And they no longer walked with him. So Jesus said to the 12, do you want to go away as well? Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have believed, and we have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. Our search is over. To who else will we go? Third and finally, you rest in the faith that he alone satisfies your deepest longings. Faith is not just an intellectual assent. I know this had a very intellectual approach today, but faith is a heart engagement. It is not just saying, I believe he is these things intellectually. It is saying, I am going to put all of my trust that he will be for me everything he claims to be. That when I die, he will hold me fast. No matter what I go through, he will hold me fast. Let's bow our heads for just a few moments of quietness and reflection. You've got enough information to respond to Christ. You really do. I'll talk more and we can have more meetings and work through your questions, but you've got plenty of information to respond. Long before we were born, Christ was not only promised, but he was expected. And in our time, having been born, we can look back and say he has also come. He lived a perfect life as our representative before God. You need not live a perfect life. You need not even have lived a good life. He did all that was needed to accomplish the right standing before God. He died on the cross as your substitute for your sin. He rose from the dead to demonstrate that death was accepted before God the Father. Death is defeated. Your sin is overcome. And Satan is defeated. We have all that before us. My call to you is simply say, I take it. I'll take it. Who do you say he is? Father, bring to our minds right now and through the week all that we've contemplated this morning about your plan for the salvation of your world and us as individuals. Help us to love that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, the Mashiach, who has been anointed to end all of our search for meaning and satisfaction. I guess ending's not even a good word to consummate it and fulfill it, because it will never end. We will have infinite satisfaction as long as we are in him. And it's in the name of Jesus the Christ that we ask these things. Redemption Church said.
As we transition to our time of communion, and those who are passing the elements around, come on up and grab those. I want to point you to the reason why we do this every week, which is because Jesus took one of those 450 some odd promises and showed how one of them pointed to him through the institution of the Lord's Supper. The night before he died was Passover. And if you know anything about your Bibles, you know that at Passover, it was a celebration of the mercy of God in Exodus when he commanded the Israelites to sacrifice a lamb and smear the blood over the doorpost. And if the blood was there, then the angel of death would pass over and not kill the firstborn son in their homes. Jesus says, "Take, eat, this is my body." It's not about the lamb, it's about me, the lamb. Take, drink, this is my blood, shed for the forgiveness of your sins. He takes that promise, he takes that picture, and he says, that's about me. And if you recall, in that passage in Luke, the people on the road to Emmaus thought, he can't be the Christ, he died. And Jesus says, that's how you know I am. Because I, the sinless Son of God, shed my blood for the sins of many. That's how that one out of 450 some promises gets fulfilled. And right now, what we're about to do is remember that one promise being fulfilled. That's why this is such a serious moment. It's why, like Greg said last week, the reason why we are so serious about this, why we examine ourselves, is because we're discerning the body and blood of Jesus. So this is for Christians only. This is as it makes its way through the rows. If you're not a Christian, just let it pass. And if you have sins that need to be confessed, fellowship that needs to be restored between you and the Lord, do that in your own time. Or simply let it pass. That's fine. But know that the perfect blood of Jesus can remove any of that stain, any of that brokenness, any of that sin, and receive it.
Stand with me and we'll sing one more together.
the Father's love for us is beyond all measure. He would give his only son to wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns his face away. Wounds which mother chosen done, many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, and upon his shoulders. My mocking voice among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there, until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me that it is finished. Boast in anything. No power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, the resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. This I know. Why should I gain? Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. This I know with all my heart, to pay my rent. But this I know. This I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my rent.
Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. My name is Rory. I'm one of the pastors here. If you're new or somewhat new, wanting to get connected to the church, take one of these connect cards in the seat backs in front of you, fill it out, either put it in the give boxes on the opposite ends of the wall back there, or take it to the connect desk. We've got a gift for you there. And some of you have expressed a desire to become a member of this church, which is awesome. The opportunity to do so starts next Sunday at 9 a.m. For 6 consecutive weeks, we're going to be having our membership class. That's not just a great way to, you know, become a member, it's the way to become a member, but also a great way to learn about the theology of our church, the history of it, how it all got started and how it is today. And then one other announcement I'll highlight is after, if you're a college student, there's lunch today after the church. You can look at the back of your bulletin for that and connect with Don Roberts for that. All right, stretch out your hands and receive this benediction. Now may Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one promised for us, be seen by us as the fulfillment of all God's promises for the world. May we stop our striving for peace and contentment in other things and claim him as the answer to our problems, the satisfier of our souls, and the healer of our hearts. Go now from this place and find in Jesus Messiah all the rest, peace, and answers that you're searching for. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all Redemption Church together said, Amen. You're dismissed.